This could
week,
be me.
A hot new
if Love Island
enters the villa.
Wasn't that phobic? I'm going out
tonight. Girls be like, oh no, I got a mom bod, I got a fupa, I got a belly. Okay, put it on his forehead. Put it on his forehead.
Fat, yes. Ugly? Absolutely fucking not.
Day and night, the lonely loner seems to free his mind at night.
Cause I am a boss bitch, now macaroni cheese and grill my swordfish. I'm a boss ass bitch. I'm a boss ass bitch. If he catch my drift, he could catch my gist. I be
doing the clean look with acne.
It has been brought to my attention that I offended some of you. I'm truly sorry. I meant to offend all of you.
Do you want to know something crazy? This is my body. Do you want to know something crazier? I don't hate it. Do you know that you can actually have a body and not hate it?
Body positivity promotes obesity. Let's talk about it. So I'm tired of hearing this argument, and it's one that we hear all the time. And as a plus size woman who's over 300 pounds, let's talk about this. So for most people who are significantly overweight, and I'm not talking about people who maybe gained weight because they got a little bit older, they had baby weight, genetics, things like that. I'm talking about people who are 100, 200, 300 pounds overweight. Typically those people have higher rates of trauma, abuse, their flight or fight symptoms, their anxiety is at a very high elevated level, and food becomes a source of chemically rebalancing their brain. We all understand that certain foods can trigger dopamine in our brain, which is called the feel-good drug, right? So a lot of people who've endured years and years and years of trauma, they had no physical protection either. When their body gains weight and they're gaining weight, they feel good from the dopamine levels and they're getting bigger. And I know for me personally, growing up and everything that I had to go through and everything I witnessed, being somebody in a bigger body meant that I could be protected, I would be safe. And so a lot of people who are dealing with significant weight gain are people who are just victims of trauma. And the reason why we're such a target is because we physically walk around with our trauma every day. You can see it quite literally on us. And body positivity teaches people how to love themselves. A lot of people who are significantly overweight, our self-esteem is shot because we live in a society that tells us that we're simply wrong for being in the body that we're being in. We've more than likely endured years of trauma without any help. And you walk around with that every single day with society throwing stones at you, and you can't help but to feel down upon yourself. And with the body positivity movement, it teaches you how to love yourself in ways you've never been taught. How to look into a mirror right now. And maybe you're at the highest weight you've ever been at. Maybe you don't like your skin complexion. Maybe you don't like your features, whatever. And learning that you are beautiful and that you are worthy and that you are here to protect your inner child, and no one can get in the way of that. And when you start to have better mental health and you start to love yourself, you in return want to do things that are going to make you feel good. This can include intuitively eating things that make you feel good, getting up and maybe going for a walk, feeling the fresh air, listening to your favorite music, things that make you feel good. So body positivity isn't promoting obesity. If anything, it's teaching.
Right, it's about the fourth time I filmed this now because I'm getting angry. I've had quite a few comments this week of people saying things like, oh, well, it works for me. Oh, well, I've lost such and such weight. Well, I know someone who works for. Each to their own. Slimming World, Weight Watchers, Slim Fast don't work for anyone. The vast majority of people are going to lose weight when they first start. Then it's going to stop. Then about 90% of people are either going to regain it, regain more weight, hello, or in some cases, get a fucking eating disorder. I lost 4 stone at Slimming World. So don't be sat there thinking that just because you've lost weight now that you've won in that equation. You ate, they're playing you. No one in diet culture, in any diet company, is winning unless you are the owner of that business, because that's where the money's going. Diet clubs will feed you lies about nutrition and health and tell you that being thin equals healthy. It's not. It's fat phobic. It's inaccurate. They want your money. They don't give a shit about your health or your well-being.
Say that your heartburn and your back pain is caused by your weight. What are we going to do about that?
If I were to prescribe you a low-calorie diet and exercise, I know that 1 to 2 thirds of that weight is going to be regained in 1 year, and almost all of it will be regained within 5. Health at Every Size is actually a multidisciplinary approach that shifts the focus from weight management to health promotion. So instead of using weight as a barometer for success, we focus on health behaviors. Health at Every Size is also a social justice movement. Patients in larger bodies face many disparities. Healthcare providers spend less time with them, are more reluctant to perform screening tests like mammograms and pelvic exams, and they're less likely to seek medical help. You are right about the shaming piece, that's called weight stigma, which negatively impacts patients even on a physiologic level. Several well-designed randomized control trials have found that Health at Every Size leads to better patient outcomes.
Just a reminder that I am very fat and very sexy, and I am 100% glorifying obesity, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Ugh, I ate so much today. I probably won't eat it all tomorrow. Yeah, I peed so much today. I just won't pee tomorrow. What? Well, I mean, like, I just really indulged myself and peed a lot, so I don't think I deserve it. But you have to. Like, your body needs to go. And your body needs to eat. You need to eat tomorrow, no matter how much you ate yesterday or today or whatever. Your body needs food. Even if you're not moving around a lot. Okay, love you.
Okay, so I want to talk about fat phobia, and it's tied to white supremacy. In the 18th century, people used to sort slaves through skin color, but as slaves started being lighter skinned because they were mating with white slave owners, that became a less reliable metric. So they started adding traits to black people to distinguish them further, and one of them was fatness. While being fat for white people was seen as being rich and being opulent, for black people it was seen as a sign for laziness, but also being sensual, which kind of sounds like a good thing now, but in the 18th century it was seen as sort of satanic to be sensual. It was a huge marketing success that we still deal with today, where we view fat people as lazier, less productive, and it's not true. So to perpetuate fat phobia is to perpetuate white supremacy.
You probably know someone who's thin, but they eat a lot and exercise very little. So why is it so wild to think that you also probably know someone who's fat, but eats very little and exercises a lot?
Fat phobes love to tattle on themselves. This is on a video about how being afraid of being fat is inherently fat phobic. She's like, I don't agree. I'm like, that's fat phobia. She's like, actually, it's because I want to be able to walk upstairs without being out of breath. That's embarrassing.